Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. So today we are gonna study skeleton and movement. In this video we'll study about the skeleton and next video we'll study about the movement. So let's begin. Basically, what is skeleton? So the body is supported within or around by a hard supportive and protective framework which is known as skeleton. So the study of bones or the skeleton is called as osteology or skeletology. Now in the vertebrate, the skeleton is mainly divided into two. So first is exoskeleton and endoskeleton. So the exoskeleton, which consists of hard parts present on the surface of the body, it is found in vertebrates and invertebrates both, for example shell in snail. Okay, and what is endoskeleton, which means present inside the body? So bones and cartilage are the hard supporting part present inside the body forming endoskeleton. Bones and cartilage are specialized connective tissue. Bones have a hard matrix due to the calcium salts in it, and the cartilage have slightly friable matrix due to the chondrocytes and salts. So let's see the function of skeleton. It gives definite shape to the body and protects the internal vital organs like heart, brain, lungs, etc. The bones and the cartilage provide surface for the attachment of muscles. It also acts as a system of liver and helps in movement of body parts and locomotions. Red blood bone marrow present at the end of the long bones and the spongy bones helps in production of RBCs, that is red blood cells, and other blood cells. Bones acts as a storehouse of calcium, potassium, magnesium, etc. So basically it gives us shape, it gives attachment to the muscles, it helps in movement and locomotion, production of red blood cells, and it's a storehouse. Human skeleton contain in total 206 bones. So they are divided into two parts. First is axial bone, that means the bone which are present along the long axis of the body, as you can see over here. So they include 80 bones. So they are of skull bones, vertebrae, sternum, ribs, auditory ossicles, they are nothing but ear bones, and hyoid bone. And the appendicular are the rest of the bones which are present in the periphery, that means in the hands and the legs. So it includes upper part, which includes 64 bones, which includes pectoral girdle bone, arms and hands, lower part, which includes pelvic girdle, that means this part, and the legs and the feet. So now let's see in detail about the axial bones. So this is the schematic diagram in which you can understand skull and the central part which is present along the body axis are included into the axial skeleton, and the appendicular means the side bones which are present over here. Let's study skull in detail. So skull in total contains 28 bones. So out of which the cranium part, that means the head part, contains 8 bones, that is frontal, occipital, parietal 2 bones, temporal 2 bones, sphenoidal 1 and ethmoidal 1. Then comes the ear ossicles. Ear ossicles means the bones which are present inside the ears. They are mandibles, incisors and stapes. And then comes the facial bones. As you can see over here, this forms the facial bones, which contain nasal bones, lacrimal bone, inferior nasal conga, vomer, palatine, zygomatic, maxilla and mandible. So now let's study each one in detail. Cranium part of the skull is formed of 8 cranial bones, that means in which brain is enclosed in it. So it consists of frontal bone, as you can see over here in yellow color, which is 1 in number. Then comes the occipital, which is present downward, which is also 1 in number. Then comes the parietal, which are 2 in number on either side, over right side and left side. Temporal bone, which is present below the parietal bone, which are also in 2 in number. Then comes the sphenoidal bone, which is present in the middle, which is 1 in number, and the ethmoidal, which is present over here inside the eye orbit, which is also 1 in number. So in total there are 8 cranial bones. So first let's see about the frontal bone, which is present in the front, and it forms the anterior part of the cranium wall, and it forms the roof, that means the upper part of the eye socket, as you can see over here. The second, which is occipital, which is also one in number, so it is present posteriorly and it supports the brain or lifts the brain. And from here, there is an opening which is known as foramen magnum, from which the spinal cord opens or spinal cord runs. The second part, which is the parietal bone, so which forms the large part of the cranial wall, and it extends from the frontal bone to the occipital bone. That means from the frontal bone to the occipital bone, in between it there is parietal bone, which are two in number on either side. Okay, then comes the temporal bone, which is present below the parietal bone, and it forms the lateral walls of the cranium bone. And this bone contains organs of hearing and equilibrium. So now let's see how frontal bone and parietal bone, temporal bone are separated from each other. So they are known as sutures. So frontal bone is separated from parietal bone through a suture, which is known as coronal suture. Parietal bone is separated by the temporal bone by a squamous suture, and parietal bone and occipital bone is separated by a suture which is known as lambdoidal suture, and both the parietal bones are separated through each other by a sagittal suture, as you can see over here. Moving on to the face part, so it is formed of mandible. This is the one long bone which is present. Then comes the maxilla over here. Then comes the zygomatic bone, which is a green in color, as you can see over here, which are two in number. Then comes the lacrimal bone, which are also two in number, as you can see over here. Then comes the nasal bone, two in number again. Then comes the inferior concha, that is present inside the nasal cavity, which forms the lateral wall of the nose. Then comes the palatine bone, and then comes the vomer, which you can see over here, this part, which is known as vomer. And palatine is nothing but the hard part which is present above the mouth. Like if you will pull your tongue, you will feel a hard substance that is nothing but a palatine bone. So let's see the zygomatic bone. So the bones which are present on the either side, so it is nothing but it forms the margin of the orbital bones, that means the orbit, eye orbit bone. Then comes the lacrimal bone, which are the paired left and right, which are present lateral to the eye socket. Now comes the nasal bone, which divides the nasal into left and right part. Then comes the inferior concha, which are present laterally on the nose, which forms the lateral wall of the nasal cavity. Then comes the palatine bone, which is formed of left and right and forms the roof of the buccal cavity. Then comes the vomer, which is the inferior part of the nasal septum. The vertical partition separating the left and right nasal cavity, as you can see over here, the left and right cavity which is separated, which is present in the middle, is known as vomer. Then comes the maxilla, so the right and left maxillary bone, as you can see over here, which forms the upper jaw, and the mandible, which forms the lower jaw. Now let's see about auditory ossicles. They are three in number. They are malleus, incus and stape, as you can see over here. The stape is the smallest bone of the body. So ear ossicles are nothing but ear bone, which are present in the middle ear. Now the second part which comes in the axial bones are the vertebral column. So vertebral column, which is also known as spinal column or backbone, as you can see over here, which is present posteriorly. So it's composed of series of bones which are known as vertebrae. So there are many bones which are present, and the singular one is known as vertebra. So about 71 cm long in adult and 61 cm long in female. Basically, during the early development, that means during the childhood, there are in total 33 bones. But when the adult is formed, like the child grows into adult, the total number of bones which are present is 26. This is because the sacrum one, this sacrum fuses into the one bone, and coccyx, which are four in number, fuses into one bone. And hence, there are in total 26 bones in adult. So, seven bones are present in the cervical region, that means the neck region. Then comes the thoracic region, where the 12 bones are present, which are numbered from T1 to T12. Then five lumbar vertebrae are present, which are numbered from L1 to L5. Then the five bones of the sacrum fuses to form the one sacrum, and the four coccyx bone fuses to form one coccyx bone. So cervical, thoracic and lumbar are movable. Sacrum and coccyx are immovable. Between adjacent vertebra, from the second cervical vertebra to the sacrum are intervertebral disc. As you can see, this is one vertebra and the second vertebra, and between them there is an intervertebral disc present. So there are seven cervical vertebrae, as you can see over here, which forms the neck. Then comes the thoracic region. So there are 12 thoracic vertebrae, five lumbar vertebrae. Then comes the sacrum and coccyx. Let's see the general structure of vertebrae. So the first one is cervical vertebrae, which is seven in number, which are named from C1 to C7. So it forms the framework of neck region, as you can see over here. It supports the skull. It is small in size, presents foramen in each transverse process. So we'll see it in detail about this transverse process. The second is thoracic vertebrae, which is 12 in number. They form the posterior part of the thoracic cage, as you can see over here, this rib cage. It articulates and is associated with the ribs. So ribs are attached to the thoracic vertebra. Now the second part, which is the lumbar region, which is a wedge bearing region, and they are large in number and forms the posterior wall of the abdominal cavity. Then comes the sacrum vertebrae, as you can see over here, which is formed by fusion of five bones. It is immovable and it articulates with the pelvic bone to form a pelvic cavity. Now the cavity which is seen over here, it's known as pelvic cavity. And the last one, which is the coccyx bone, which is formed by the fusion of four coccyx bone. It also forms a part of pelvic cavity. So in adult, there are four slight bands called as normal curve. So the cervical and the lumbar curve are convex. That means they are bulging. As you can see over here, this is cervical and this is lumbar, which are convex. And the thoracic and the sacrum are concave in bulging, that is cupping in. Okay, so these are the normal curves which are present. Let's see the parts of typical vertebra. So one vertebrae is how formed, let's see. So it consists of body. So this is the body, which is placed anteriorly. Then comes the vertebral arch, which is formed of laminae and pedicel, as you can see over here. Then there is a vertebral foramen through which the spinal cord passes. Then there are seven processes, two lateral transverse process, as you can see over here, one spinous process, which is present posteriorly. And there are four articular process, two superior articular process, as you can see over here, and two inferior articular process, as you can see in the lateral view. Now what happens is, this inferior articular process of the upper vertebra joins with the superior articular process of the lower vertebra, and in this way the whole vertebral column is formed. Let's see about cervical vertebrae. So there are seven in number, which forms the framework of the neck. So out of which C1, C2 and C7 are atypical. That means they look weird or they look different from the typical vertebra which we saw in last slide. So from C3 to C6 there has similarities. That means they are known as typical vertebrae. So they are small body. As you can see over here, there is small body. Then there is a large vertebral arch. Then there is a vertebral foramen present. On the transverse process, there is presence of foramen transversum, as you can see on both the side. Now this is typical, or this is only present in cervical vertebrae only. Transverse foraminism is present only in cervical vertebrae. And there is spinous process, which is short and bifidic. Now let's see about C1, C2, which are look different from typical vertebrae. So let's see about atypical cervical vertebra. So the first vertebra, which is also known as atlas, so it's a ring-shaped structure as you can see over here. There is no body present, there is no spinous process present. There are superior facet which articulates with the occipital condyle and forms a yes joint. And also there are anterior arch and a posterior arch. Then the second part, which is atlas second cervical vertebra. It's similar to the cervical vertebra. It has body, but it has some process which is known as odontoid process. It also has superior articular facet, which articulates with the inferior articular facet of the atlas and forms a no joint. It's a pivot type of joint. It has spinous process, which is short and bifid in structure, as you can see over here. Now, let's see about thoracic vertebra. So there is large body. The body is in heart shape. It also contains transverse process, contains a facet for attachment of the ribs. Lumbar vertebra, which are from L1 to L5, they are strongest and the largest vertebrae because they are weight bearing. They are thickest, they have thickest body, and their body is of kidney shape. Then comes the sacrum, which is from S1 to S5, but they fuses and form one bone. It is an inverted triangular in shape, as you can see over here. So it's a sacrum serves strong foundation of the pelvic girdle attachment. That means it forms a sacroiliac joint. That means it joins the pelvic bone and forms a sacroiliac joint. Then comes the coccyx, which is from C1 to C4, but they fuses and form into a one bone. It is also an inverted triangular in shape, and it also forms a part of the pelvic girdle. Then let's see about bony thorax. So the bony thorax refers to the entire chest, and it's made up of bone and cartilage. So it consists of sternum anteriorly. Then there are ribs, which 12 pairs of ribs, and then comes the costal cartilage, which connects the sternum and the ribs, and the posteriorly there are vertebrae, which are known as thoracic vertebrae. Now first let's see the sternum, which is also known as breastbone or chest bone. So it is one in number. It is present anteriorly. It's made up of three main parts: manubrium, which is also known as handle, the uppermost part. Then comes the body, which is middle part, and the last part, which is known as xiphoid process, which is the lower part. Now let's see in detail each part. So let's see the first part, which is also known as manubrium or handle. So there is an articular facet over here, which is for articulation of the clavicle, that is the collarbone, and there is an articulation for the first rib, which is also present over here. Then there is a body where there are seven facet for articulation of the ribs. And then the last, which is xiphisternal process, which is the last process where there is it consists of hyaline cartilage, that is during the infancy and childhood, but that cartilage ossified till the age of 40, and there are no ribs attachment over there present. Then comes the ribs. So there are 12 pairs of ribs. They are flat bones. Each ribs is posteriorly attached to the 12th thoracic vertebrae. The head of the rib articulates with the body of the thoracic vertebrae through a transverse process present on the thoracic vertebra. Now, what are the characteristics? So there are two extremities. First one is vertebral extremities, which has head, neck and tubercle, which articulates with the transverse process of the thoracic vertebra, and the costal extremities, which articulate with the costal cartilage, and then the costal cartilage in short attached to the sternum and forms the anterior wall. Depending upon the attachments, ribs are classified into three types. So the first is true ribs, which are from 1 to 7. So they are attached to the sternum by a costochondral cartilage, as you can see over here. Now there are false rib, in which what happens is 8 to 10 ribs, 8th, 9th and 10th ribs are fused and are joined to the 7th rib. Hence they are known as false ribs. They are not attached to the sternum. Then the floating ribs, which are from 11th and 12th, what happens in this is they do not have an anterior connection, as you can see over here. They are only posteriorly connected to the thoracic vertebra. Now the smallest bone which is present in the throat is the hyoid bone. It does not articulate with any other bone. Suppose the tongue provides attachment site for some tongue muscles and also for the muscles of the neck and the pharynx. So now let's see first about the girdle. So first is pectoral girdle, which attaches the upper limbs to the trunk. So as you can see over here, this is clavicle and scapula, which forms the upper, and the upper limbs is attached to it. Now this forms a pectoral girdle. Now comes second is pelvic girdle, which attaches the lower limbs to the trunk. So these are the lower limbs and this is the pelvic girdle, which is formed by pelvis bone and sacrum and coccyx. Pectoral girdle consists of clavicle and scapula. So let's see clavicle. It is also known as collarbone. It is an horizontally placed, which is superior to thorax. That means it is situated above the thorax region, as you can see over here. Now the sternal end, that means the medial end, attaches to the manubrium of the sternum, and the acromial end articulates with the scapula. As you can see over here, this is an acromial end which attaches to the scapula. Now moving on to scapula, so it lies on the dorsal surface of the ribcage. Dorsal surface means it lies on the posterior side on the either side of the vertebra column. So it is located between 2 to 7 ribs. It has 3 borders. So the first one is the superior border, then comes the medial border, which is also known as vertebral border, and the last one is the lateral border. At the lateral side, there is a cavity which is known as glenoid cavity. So in which what happens is the head of the femur joins and forms a shoulder joint. Now let's see the bones of the upper limb. So it's made up of humerus, as you can see over here. Then it is formed of radius and ulna. Then comes carpals, metacarpals and phalanges. So now the humerus is divided into head, shaft and trochlear, or a lower part. Now this head articulates with the scapula and forms the shoulder joint. Below, this humerus articulates with the ulna and radius to form elbow joint. So this ulna, which is present on the medial side, articulates with the femur by an olecranon process, as you can see over here. And the radius articulates, the head articulates with the head of the femur and forms a elbow joint. So this is an elbow joint which is formed, as you can see over here. The radius lies towards the thumb, as you can see, that is laterally. Now let's see about the hand. So the hand is formed of carpal bones, then comes the metacarpal bone, 5 metacarpal bone, then comes the phalanges. So it's a proximal phalange, middle phalange, and then comes the distal phalange. So this is the anatomy of the hand. Now the second part, which is the pelvic girdle, it is formed of pelvis bone. This is the pelvis bone, which is also known as coxal bone. It is formed of 3 fusion of bones, that is ilium, ischium and pubis. It articulates with the sacrum and it forms a iliosacral joint. Now this cavity which is formed, it is known as pelvic girdle. On the pelvic bone, there is a cavity over here. This is known as acetabulum, in which the head of the femur fits, and this forms the hip joint. Now, let's see the bones of the lower limb. So, it is formed of femur. This is the longest and the strongest bone. Now, this femur articulates with tibia and fibula to form a knee joint. In front of the knee joint, there is a bone which is known as patella. Now this forms the leg. This is the thigh. This is the leg. Calf muscles are formed over here. Calf is present over here. And the last part of which is feet. So it is formed of tarsal bones, metatarsal bones and phalanges. Now let's see this in detail. So it consists of tarsal bone. This part is known as metatarsal bone. And the last which are known as phalanges. So this forms the toe. So there are again three phalanges, proximal, middle and distal. This forms the feet. Thank you. Hope you like this video. Please don't forget to like, share and subscribe and share your views in the comment section below. Till then, bye.